Hello and welcome to this lecture about Zero Trust Architecture. This lecture is part of the Network Security course. And in this lecture, I'm going to talk about the concept of Zero Trust Security, which is widely known concept nowadays in network security, and it replaces the old traditional view of network security, which is trusted versus untrusted networks. So it's this course is a little bit, or this lecture is a little bit on the theoretical side of things, but I will try to make sure that there are enough talk about implementation and practical things to make this topic useful. All right, so let's start by looking at the references. Most of these references come actually from open or available sources on the internet, mainly the National Institute of Standards and Technology. There's also a book about zero trust security. All right, so in the next few slides, I'll cover the concept of zero trust in general, and then we'll go into a little bit more details. So the zero trust model is a recent approach to network security that the idea behind it is the trust is not granted. Instead, it's being evaluated every time. Every time there's an attempt to access a resource in the network, a trust or the access is being checked, and the user is being evaluated and granted this access based on the conditions of that particular connection. All right, so it zero trust requires strict identity verification, and also, as I said, the access is always tied when the user is trying to connect and what kind of application, and the surrounding conditions. The zero trust is supposed to prevent any unauthorized access and data breaches by assuming that every request is a potential threat. So we don't trust anybody, and we want to be we want to check every time there is an access. Zero trust in general is not a specific technology, is not a particular appliance or particular software application that you're going to go buy and that's the zero trust. And it's a framework. It's more of a framework or an umbrella of a lot of technologies that help implement this concept. So in contrast with the traditional approach to security, as we saw before in previous lectures, the idea was there is a trusted network, maybe the private LAN, and the untrusted network, maybe the internet, and we want to control access or traffic between these two networks, right? And once the access is granted, well, you're free to do whatever you want the inside network. Always, also, based on the traditional view of network security, any lateral movements, any traffic between two devices inside the private LAN is implicitly trusted. So we don't check. One server wants to contact another server, one client wants to contact another server inside the LAN itself, that is trusted, and we allow it, we don't check it, right? In zero trust, that's not allowed. Everything is checked, we don't assume any particular trust anywhere, right? And that means that if you look at it from, again, from the old view, we can control the traffic between the untrusted and trusted network by a firewall. The firewall could be one firewall for the entire network. The network itself can be very complicated network with a lot of subnets, a lot of VLANs, routers, whatever. But to the outside, there is only one firewall, or in general, there is only one checkpoint, right? Which in a case of a complicated network, that checkpoint, that firewall is very, very far away from any internal infrastructure. Zero Trust says, no, we want to move these decision points, whether you access a resource or not, we want to move it closer to the resource. If we think about the resource as a server, we want to make a decision about what or who can access that server very close to the server itself rather than somewhere away from it. All right, so there are tenets of Zero Trust. These are the principles that we rely on. The first one is all enterprise systems are considered resources. In this case, the enterprise system could be servers, applications, the network devices themselves, links, anything inside or part of the enterprise system, part of the IT system is considered a resource. So when we talk about a resource, we talk about all of these things. The enterprise ensures that all owned systems are in their most secure state possible. This means also that we want to secure all of these resources, so nothing is left unsecure. So we want to assume that all of these systems are secured. And they are what we mean by secure resources is that if we discover vulnerability in an operating system, we need to patch that vulnerability and eliminate it, right? If we want to harden the servers, we want to make sure that all best practices known to secure these resources are applied. All communication is done in a secure manner regardless of network location. Again, back to the traditional view, in Zero Trust, we want to make sure that everything, all the traffic, all the communication is secure. Now, how secure is that? We have different tools for that, but all communication is done in a secure manner. Number four, access to individual enterprise resources granted on bare connection basis. Again, we don't just grant a user to come into the network and then they are free to do whatever they want. No, every connection is supposed to be checked and access is granted on connection per connection basis rather than just a blank check to access any resource. And to implement that, the authentication itself, authenticating users, authenticating subjects, has to be dynamic, has to change depending on the status of the network, depends on the status of the subject, the user, and also needs to be enforced per connection, per access. The status or the state of the user depends on the time, depends on maybe the reason for the connection, depends on environmental factors, all of these things. All right, so these are the tenets, the six tenets of Zero Trust. Again, when you think about Zero Trust from the point of view of a network, there are things that we need to be aware of. First, the entire enterprise private network is not implicitly trusted and communication should be highly secure. Again, enforcing the same points that I made before. Devices on the network may not be owned or configured by the enterprise. There is this concept of bring your own device that has been gaining traction for years now, for maybe over a decade. The idea is employees can bring their own devices and do business, the enterprise business, using their own devices. Right? This actually enforces the idea that there is no secure network anymore. The private network cannot be trusted anymore because simply people can bring their own devices, which cannot be trusted. So that another factor that enforces the idea that we shouldn't have any trust in the private network. So no resource is inherently trusted. Security posture evaluation is always required for every asset. Again, the resources themselves, what we talked about, anything that's owned by the organization is considered resource. So these resources also are not trusted. And then we also have this now, the use of cloud infrastructure is more ubiquitous, more often enterprises use cloud. So we cannot trust the remote subjects and assets either, right? And any communication has to be authenticated and has to be secured. So all of these enforces the idea that we really don't want to have any trust in the network at all, right? If you use some other security terminology, we can express these concepts as we have now the attack surface of the network is so big that we don't really have a small perimeter that we can control anymore, right? In the past, you may think, all right, so the inside network includes desktops, includes servers, and these are owned by the organization, and we can control all aspects, what kind of applications, who access these devices, all of this. Nowadays, you can bring your own laptop, you can bring your own phone to the inside network, you can connect to the wireless network inside. The servers themselves can be somewhere located in the cloud. So there isn't any known perimeter anymore. So the perimeter or whatever is considered the inside is not really inside anymore. It can be anywhere, right? There are remote users. There are users who are bringing their own devices. Servers are located in the cloud. So the area that we need to protect is huge, right? And therefore, the only solution is to say, I'm not trusting anything, right? Okay, so here is the first look at the zero trust architecture from the logical point of view. And what I want you to see here, or what I want you to remember, is the middle part, which are the main components. So, but generally speaking, there are input comes from different systems. We have seen some of them and we haven't seen others in previous lectures. So we talked about data access policies or access controls. We talked about public key infrastructure. We talked about identity management, SIM logs. There are other resources that or other inputs to the architecture we didn't cover just yet. Information about recent threat or threat intelligence, regulations and industry standards, CDM systems, all of these are constitute the input of the architecture. The architecture itself includes, if you look at the bottom part, you will see that we have the subject and the resource. We talked about these before in the access control lecture. the subject and this is the object, and there is between them what now we will call it the policy enforcement point. And the policy enforcement point is the checkpoint that implement or grants access of the subject or to the subject, to the object. The subject can be a human, can be a person, or it can be a process or an application, right? And this will be the control, the data plane responsible for actual forwarding of packets in case of a network or access to the resources in general. The control plane is what makes the decisions. So we have two pieces here, the policy engine and the policy administrator, and the two of them combined are called policy decision point. So this is the general architecture. Let's look at each one of these pieces. So at the core, we have the control plane. It's responsible for establishing and enforcing policies. Requests for access to protected resources are first made through the control plane, where both the device and user must be authenticated and authorized. So this is the part where it's responsible for authorization and authentication. And this part is always continuously making decisions in real time about who and what can access the resource. So this is where the decision is made. And this decision is made similar to the topic of access control. The decision is made based on authorization and based on rules. All right, the data plane carries out the policy. This is the enforcement, right? Decisions are made in the control plane, and it carries out the policies in the data plane. It provides, is the mechanism that provides access to the resources, and if you look at it from the network perspective, it delivers the packet to the right destination. All right, if we look in more details about the core, see at the top, there's the policy engine. The policy engine is the component that evaluates resource access requests, then grants or denies the request. How's that being done? Well, if you remember the inputs, both sides here, this is what the PE, the policy engine, relies on information from various data sources like access logs, threat intelligence, endpoint health, ID, authentication, etc. This is where it gets this input and makes based the decisions based on the input. Example of policy engine could be a centralized server that collects the data from all these resources and apply sets of rules to determine if a subject needs to or granted access or not to the resource. The policy administrator is the part that controls communication between the subject and the target resource. It logs all the access decisions and enforces the policies defined by the PE. And an example of this is a proxy server, right? A proxy server can sit between a server and client and acts as the intermediate point. And now, as we talked about proxy before, it monitors, not just monitors, actually intercepts all the traffic and looks at it and pass it along if it's allowed to pass. A policy enforcement point, or PEP, is the component that enables, monitors, and terminates connections that are not compliant with the policy. The example of that is a firewall. So you see here multiple devices that contribute to this. And they can be, here are the these are just examples, but can be implemented by different mechanisms, right? But generally speaking, these are the components And sometimes there is an overlap between the functions, although we'll see later in the slides that they should be separated, these functions. All right, so the data sources, this is again in the diagram here. We'll talk about each one of them separately. Most of them we have visited before. So the external data sources are, we have a continuous diagnostic and mitigation system. We didn't talk about this before, but it talks about or provides asset information, patch status, and vulnerabilities. Remember when I said that the systems or the resources in the system has to be always secure, and whenever we discover vulnerability, we have to eliminate it. So this is a source for that information. Then we have industry compliance systems. So systems usually, enterprises usually comply with either regulations, that these are laws, or some kind of industry standards to show that their security are up to a certain level of standard, or they adhere to the local regulations. So this is a good source of making decisions, right, based on these standards and regulations. Then we have the threat intelligence feed or feeds. They supply information about any known attacks, any known vulnerabilities, any known malware. We talked about logs before, so these are network and system activity logs. We talked about data access policies when we talked about access controls. We talked about public key infrastructure. We talked about identity management systems when we talked about security systems. And we talked about SIM security information and event management, which collects, analyzes logs and find correlation and detect any attacks or threats. So all of these, or most of these, have been visited before, and they all form inputs for the data for the zero trust architecture. All right, we have multiple approaches or multiple ways to implement zero trust architecture. So it's not one size fit all, or not one system, but many, many systems. And they all differ in how granular the systems are. So the simplest way we can look at it as, all right, so if I implement a firewall between multiple zones inside the network, that could be one approach, and I'll talk about this later on, but that could be one approach to implement zero trust architecture. We will see that maybe this does not fulfill all the zero trust architecture requirements, but it could be one approach. There are approaches also that go more granular in the implementation. So instead of either in and out, or out of the zone, but could be just in and out of an application or in and out of a server. So it can be more granular or coarse. All right, so there are approaches also that vary in where the policy rules are used. So let's take a look. Enhanced identity governance driven approach. These are policies based on identity and assigned attributes with access determined by the subject privileges. When we talked about access controls before, we said that some models for access control assigns subjects privileges based on clearance, for example, right? So with a clearance, with a subject being cleared to access certain resources, the subject can access those resources, but also access those resources with some limitations. Limitations like, okay, so the project that they're working on right now, or the task that they are doing right now. So it's not, it's having clearance to access the resource doesn't mean that you access all the resources in that level of clearance anytime you want, right? So the device, the asset status, environmental factors may influence the access decisions, and this could be good for open network models and cloud-based services. So it could be used for certain types of access, but not for others. Then we have micro-segmentation approach. Resources are placed on unique network segments protected by gateway security components. So you can probably are familiar with this, or the simplest way, you can put all servers in one network segment, and then you control access to that segment by a firewall, for example, right? These gateways dynamically grant access based on individual request and require robust device management, and this can be useful for discrete resources mean individual servers, for example, or individual devices, and also for cloud services. We can also go more granular and say network infrastructure and software defined perimeters approach. So you know that SDN, for example, software defined networking, can provide more granular management of flows based on individual flows, which each flow will have a source and destination and probably certain applications. So we can have more granular control in that. Something else called intent-based networking. This type of networking, the idea behind it is that let's imagine the network administrator say, okay, I want to implement the VLAN between point A and point B. So the network infrastructure figure out by itself what are the configuration required to implement such VLAN across the network. So without or with minimal input from the administrator. So these type of network, we call them intent-based networking. And they could be also implemented using SDN. So we can use this kind of networking to implement zero trust infrastructure. And now the policy decisions are made by the policy engine, and the network is configured accordingly, whether you allow something or you deny it based on the policy engine. You can implement this approach for agent gateway. We'll talk about this in a minute. Cloud virtual networks or other models. So you can use this for different types of networks and different types of systems. So we have zero trust architecture deployment models. There are variations of how the abstract architecture are implemented. So they all achieve zero trust architecture, but at different levels. It depends on the situation of the infrastructure, and it depends on the organization requirements. Right? So as I said before, there is no one-size-fit-all model. So you can choose which one of these models that is suitable for your infrastructure, for your enterprise. So the first model here, we talked about agent gateway-based deployment. So the same picture is repeated. Notice that we have the control plane and the data plane in all of them. We have the policy engine, we have the policy administrator, and we have the PEP, which is the policy informs point. And sometimes the terminology or the term changes, but the idea is there is a PEP in each one of these. So the idea here is, well, first of all, when we see the word agent, this means a piece of software that's installed, right, in a system. So a management agent will be a process or software that's implemented in a device to do management, right? In this case, we're talking about security agent. So the security agent here, so we have the enterprise system, And this agent is work in coordination with the policy administrator. And the agent looks at all the access requests, pass them to the gateway, and the gateway sits in front of the data resource. So the gateway here, or the resource here, could be a server, and the gateway is the one that with the coordination of the agent allows the access to the resource. This model is good for enterprises with very good, robust device management. So all of these systems are under good control. We or the enterprise controls everything. The enterprise system could be a switch, could be a router, could be any kind of device here. And the resource here could be a database or application that accesses a database. And when the infrastructure has control of all of these devices, so obviously to install an agent, you have to be able to have access to the enterprise system, and it's under your control. And if you replicate this across all the resources, then you have a very good control of all access. So the agent here, or the requests, are evaluated by the policy engine, and authorized communication paths are configured between the agent and the gateway. So now policy engine decides who gets in and who's not, implements these policies in the agent and the gateway, and between them they either allow or deny access from the subject. Okay. A less granular model is the enclave-based deployment. Here you will see the difference. Instead of one resource, we have group of resources and one gateway, right? So in terms of networking, the analogy will be I'm putting multiple servers inside a VLAN, and I'll control the access to the VLAN with the gateway, which could be a firewall or a router with a access list that controls access. So this gateway can be implemented in different ways. So an enclave refers to a group of resources that share the same security requirements and policies. So let's say application servers. The resource enclave can be physical or logical. It could be a switch that creates a subnet, or it could be a VLAN, right? The gateway protect the resource enclaves, and this could be also sort of a live together with this model, where some resources maybe as individual controls, while others will have collective control here with the gateway. So you can look at it here as an intermediate or a general way to, let's say, all these servers require the same kind of access, so we'll just put them together. Now, from the zero trust architecture, maybe we go less granular by using this. But again, as I said, every enterprise has to implement a certain level of zero trust. Not all of them can implement the same model. Okay, so in another model here, this is good for accessing resources that may not be totally under your control, like something in the internet, or the cloud, I mean. So in this case, I may not be able to put the resources behind a firewall inside a VLAN. I don't have this available to me. So in this case, I'll use the system called a gateway portal. In this case, the subject the user here will have a system that rather than accessing the data resource directly, it has to go through the gateway portal, and this will be the one that passes traffic or denies is based on the engine policy, policy engine and the policy administrator. Another scenario where this is good is when you implement or when you have bring your own device policy in the organization. Now, because of that, your users who have their own devices may not, you may not have control over those devices. So instead of trying to implement any of the other systems, you can say, okay, every time you access this resource, you have to go through this portal that allows you or denies the access to the resource behind it. Another model is to have application sandboxing. So every application, it's surrounded by a sandbox, and the sandbox it allows the application to work in a safe environment, isolated from everything else. And then you have the PEP, which is the policy enforcement point outside, and grants access to the application based on the policies. Okay. This is another example of a very granular control. So now you're not even controlling an a server, but you're controlling access to each application individually. And this could be a good model when you try to access sensitive applications, and you can implement it, use different mechanisms. For example, you can implement it using virtual machines or containers inside the virtual machines, or sometimes using operating system features like namespaces in Linux, for example. So all of these different mechanisms to implement this concept. Some operating systems implement some of this form. We don't call them zero trust, but they have this concept. So for example, Android has this idea that every application is working in a bubble by itself, and it's isolated from all the other applications inside the operating system. And if you are an Android user, you may notice that you need special permissions to access other features or other resources in your phone, right? So this could be somewhat a good example of imagining this kind of a model. Okay, so we talked about the policy engine, the policy administrator, but now we're gonna take a look at how they work. So we'll call this the zero trust architecture trust algorithm. And if you notice here that the algorithm has input, access request, subject database and history, access asset database, resource policy requirement, threat intelligence and logs, these are the inputs. So let's take a look. The access request is the information about who is requesting access to what resource and what under what conditions. The subject database is the information about the identity and attributes of the user or device requesting access, such as the rules, permissions, credentials, etc. So this is where we put the information about the users. The asset database and observable status. So the resources themselves, we have a database for them as an input that describe the resource, its location, type, sensitivity level, all of this information, and the current status of the network, any availability information, performance information, threats information, etc. Availability in this case means I may restrict access based on time, right? So that would be, okay, so is this resource available at this time or not, time of day or time of the time of a month, for example, the last 3 days of the month, something like that. Resource requirements, the information about the minimum level of trust and security needed to access the resource. So how do we access the resource? Do we need encryption? Do we need authentication? Do we need authorization? What are the minimum level of trust that we need? And then general threat intelligence. So this is the information, external information about what is the current threats, right? Malware, phishing, denial of service, etc. So all of these 6 points form the input to the trust algorithm. The trust algorithm takes these points, evaluate them, give different weights to different inputs, and use the combination, use the rules and the combination of this input to make decisions, right? So you may end up with a trust score or a level of access to each request. So here is the request coming. All right, I have certain rules, and based on the input, so I'm going to make a decision whether this request is coming or not. So you, if the request passes a certain threshold, then okay, the trust, the access is granted. If the request does not meet the threshold, then the request is denied. For the zero trust architecture to work, this algorithm has to be dynamic and has to be adaptive. So the all of this input that we talked about is not constant. It changes, and therefore the algorithm has to make decisions based on the change as well. So for example, the same user is coming from the local network, so they may be granted access. The user goes outside the network and try to access the same resource remotely. Well, maybe now the conditions changed, the location is different, this user is not allowed to access the resource anymore, right? Or the resource is the same, the information is the same, but then there's a known threat detected. So, okay, so to protect this asset or the resource, we won't allow users to access it anymore, or we need a higher level of authorization to access. All right. So we talked about the zero, the architecture, and we talked about the control plane and the data plane. So each one of these planes have a different job, right? So the control plane is used by the infrastructure components to configure assets, grant or deny access to resources. And the data plane is the one is actually forwards data, right? Handles actual communication between software components. So from the network, what are the network requirements that needs that we need to support zero trust architecture? So first of all, visibility. Visibility means from this point of view is the network should be able to monitor and collect data on users, devices, resources, and traffic, right, to establish a baseline. You cannot implement zero trust architecture on a network that doesn't have monitoring. You don't see what's going on inside, right? And to be able to monitor the network, you need to implement monitoring protocols. You need different monitoring protocols, which is a subject of another course, but you need to have a visibility on what kind of traffic going in and out of the network or within the network itself, within a segment itself. The other network requirements is the segmentation or zoning. We talked about zoning in other lecture, but the idea is you need to be able to divide the resources into zones, and each zone will have the devices of each each zone will have a similar security requirements and similar security policies to access those resources, right? Another requirement is automation. The network should be able to automate the policy enforcement controls and respond to incidents. Back to the lecture here, and we said that the algorithm has to be adaptive, right? So, because if it's not adaptive, then it's really you are not being able to react to new threats or new conditions, not just necessarily threats, but new conditions, right? So you need to have certain level of automation. You want to change the access control on the fly to prevent an attack. So you need some kind of automation. Automation happens at different levels for different devices. And adaptability. So the automation actually supports the adaptability. You cannot be adaptive without having some level of automation. So adaptability, the network should be able to adapt to environment changes, including new users, new devices, new resources, or threats. You add new users, the network should be able to handle that. You plug in a new server to the network, the architecture or the network in this case has to adapt to this and to this ad in the network and so on. Okay, we talked about three approaches and we talked about four or five different models to implement. So just to remind everybody, so the approaches we talked about are the three main approaches: enhanced identity governance, micro segmentation, network infrastructure, and software defined perimeters. And then we talked about certain models, 1, 2, 3, 4, right? And so now we're going to talk about some implementations. So identity management systems play a crucial role, a vital role in zero trust architectures, because if you noticed all the previous slides talk about we granting access to users, right? And how do we grant access to users? By identity management systems. So this is the general architecture of typical identity management system. We have the identity stores, which are the databases that includes the users and the resources. The identity life cycle, which includes provisioning and later deprovisioning or removing users. And then we have the access management controls themselves when they rely on, there's the authorization policies and authentication mechanisms. So this has been repeated again in the slide. So identity store, and there are more actually, more details. So identity stores or directories, the most famous one is the LDAP. And these are widely used for authentication identity management systems. Life cycle of identity goes from joining to moving to leaving. Right, a user is moved, and then it could move. A user is joining an enterprise, so a new account is created, and then moving either up or from department to department. So authorization changes based on the moves, and then eventually leaving. So the life cycle itself, it goes through phases. There are also non-human accounts. In access controls, we're not always talking about humans. We're talking about sometimes an application needs to access a database. So we need to handle, or the identity management systems handles that as well. Identity governance defines or involves defining access policies throughout the identity life cycle and adheres to compliance rules, especially sometimes financial controls. But I can add also sometimes we need to, in health systems, we need to adhere to certain regulations about accessing health information, for example, right? Access controls, decisions, whether manual or automatic, impact user characteristics, group membership, and permissions in the software systems. Then we have zero trust aligned identity governance. Principles of identity governance should align with zero trust policies for robust security. And finally, privileged access management. So these are the, we'll call them PAM solutions, include service accounts, vaults, and services to address privilege and access management issues. All of these components are part of identity management systems. And we talked about identity management systems in a previous lecture, and there are actually more details about this. So I encourage you to look at those components. So as I said before, identity and access, so this is the IAM, identity and access management systems, are crucial in zero trust. It's almost a must component in zero trust. So why? Because they are used to authenticate entities, whether humans or not, and provide context, rules, and characteristics for policy decisions. Any zero trust platform, any zero trust product out there needs to collect identity from identity and access management systems to make decisions about access. The principles of access management apply to all deployment models, right? So all the previous deployment models need some kind of access, it needs some kind of identity management systems, regardless of what the model is. So that's a universal requirement. So that's one of the ways we can implement. Remember, we're talking about implementations, right? Another way to implement zero trust architecture is the old-fashioned network access control. We have seen network access control mechanisms before, such as the IEEE 802.1x. The idea behind the network access controls is to the supplicant or the user here talks to authenticator, which could be a wireless access point or just a regular switch, network switch. Before the user device can access the network and send any packets, it has to authenticate. So the authenticator requests access from the authentication service, which could be Radius server, and the Radius server will grant or deny access. The protocols used is EAPOL, which is could be it is part of 802.1x. You see here identity management systems being used. Sometimes it's optional because you can configure things manually here for certain users, but you could also plug in identity management systems to do all of this. So this is the basically the architecture of IEEE 802.1x. The system here, the network access systems, allow the user to access the network, but the access is not granular. The access is either all or nothing, right? So this is one of the limitations of this type of implementation. of zero trust. The authenticator can either allow the user to go into the network or not. So there's no specific, you know, you can go to the server, but you cannot go to the server, or you can access this, but you cannot access that. So to implement that, you have to have something else. You may add more control by adding a firewall, for example, that allows certain traffic to go to a server but not others. So you may need more services here. But in general, you can look at IEEE 802.1x as a practical implementation of zero trust architecture. All right, moving on. This is the same slide, I think. For network access, you can implement the same principles for wireless access as well. So a lot of enterprises, a lot of organizations will create a guest wireless access to provide limited access to the network to visitors, to contractors, partners. And actually, one of a good implementation of 802.1x is controlling access to these wireless guest networks. So the network access control authenticate the guest users and assign them to separate VLAN or separate SSID, and to limit their access only to that resource that they need. Most likely, in most cases, the guest will be allowed only to the internet. But let's say you have a contractor or part-timer who wants to have access to certain applications and certain databases while they are working for the organization. So you may provide access to those contractors, part-timers, just to those resources that they need. The network access control also provides a mechanism to monitor and audit guest activities, right? So you know who logged in at what time and what they did during the session, and also when the session expires, when people leave. We'll just take a look at guest wireless networks, or Wi-Fi in particular. So these are usually they have a special requirements, right? These are offered on a network access offered to people who not necessarily employees, and so therefore we don't trust them completely. So the idea of guest Wi-Fi network could be an example of how we implement a zero trust architecture in the enterprise. We could secure the guest Wi-Fi networks by implementing more strict rules. Could be a higher level of authentication, DNS filtering, so we don't allow users to go to certain destinations that are normally allowed for employees. We could use IDS, IPS systems to monitor traffic and detect anomalies. We could also use the guest wireless networks to offer connectivity to employees when they bring their own devices. So we could also say, well, while working for the organization, you either use the enterprise issued laptop, and that will allow you to access certain resources. But if you bring your own laptop or your own phone, you will be able to access certain resources, but through the guest Wi-Fi, and you have a limited abilities here, right? So maybe check your emails, right? So rather than access a database. Another implementation of the zero trust architecture is to use or to have an employee bring your own device. So bring your own device is a popular approach to offering services to employees or allowing employees to access network enterprise network or enterprise system services using their own devices. This became popular because it cuts a lot on expenses by the organizations. So from the organization point of view, okay, you basically were doing business at the expense of the users. But also, there's also the other argument, which is the users, they already have phones, they already like, they use their own laptops, so why force them to use different devices? So they want to use their own resources here when they go home or when they are traveling, so we'll allow them to use the same resources when they are in the office as well. Okay, so in some sense, it's a win-win for both. But from the security point of view, it introduces a lot of challenges. You don't know what's on the device. Is it secure device? What kind of security the users adhering to? Do they have firewall? Do they check for viruses? So all of this is unknown. Therefore, the device itself is not trusted. All right, so we may implement the concept of zero trust architecture on bring your own device concept here. So there are different configuration approaches. The first one is the pure bring your own device, which means that we don't really control anything on the user device. Bring whatever you want. Now we can do the network access control so that we at least we control who comes in to the network. If they are an employee, they can be checked, they authenticate, and if they have the right credentials, we allow them to go in. And we may allow them to go in only to the guest network if we don't have any trust in their devices whatsoever, right? This is a coarse grained, which means that either in or nothing. It's either all or nothing. So we don't have a granular control. So once they go into the wireless network, whatever in the wireless network or access through the wireless network will be accessible to them. So we cannot control specific application or specific servers. We could make sure that only the on-premise users are able to access the Wi-Fi. So if you are at home, you won't be able to access anything. So you may be able to only to do this while on the premise. So you go close to the perimeter of the wireless network, so you'll be able to access the wireless resources. Another form is bring your own device with corporate certificate. In this case, all right, so we can allow you to access resources, but only if you have a certificate issued by the organization. So also this one could have maybe not as wide open as the pure bring your own device, but it's also not very granular either. So if you are on the building of the enterprise on premise, you can be able to access the resources, but you need a certificate to authenticate you, and you can have limited access because we still don't trust. Authentication doesn't guarantee that your laptop doesn't have a virus, right? So authentication is one thing, but it's not complete security here. The most restrictive form of bring your own device is with the software that your enterprise loads on your private phone or private laptop, and that will allow you to access network resources as long as you are using that software. and nothing else, no other traffic can be generated from your device, right? Some organizations will implement a software or ask you to install a software on your laptop, and one, if you want to access those the network, then you have to switch mode, which basically allows you to go into that mode, and within that mode you cannot do and you cannot use all the applications on your laptop. You only use applications that are authorized by the organization. You can still, it's kind of a restricted mode, where once you are in that mode, you will be able to access the network resources, but you cannot bring something from outside that mode in. So if you have a Word document that you created at home, you won't be able to bring it in that mode. So you have a restrictive mode here. There are a lot of products, bring your own device products, in the market, different variations. That's not really our concern here, but we just need to know that bring your own device is one of the ways you can implement zero trust architecture. And just a point that I want to make, that each one of these implementations can be part of one network, so you may need to implement a group of them, not exclusive, so each one of them can be part of the bigger zero trust architecture in the enterprise. Encryption also plays an important role in zero trust. So encryption can be implemented by different mechanism, IPsec, TLS. It says here that primarily using TLS, because TLS gives us more granular control. IPsec can be used to connect a site to a site, or a remote user to a site, but that's not granular enough, right? To make sure that I can access only one application, then TLS is much better for that purpose. So TLS is great for implementing zero trust concepts. But zero encryption in general is a double-sided or double-edged sword, as I mentioned before. From one point of view, everything encrypted is hidden. Nobody can see it, which means that it maintains the privacy of the communication. On the other hand, it's a nightmare for the security people, because the VPN or the encrypted traffic can be a malicious software coming from the inside the network, or it could be leaked data, sensitive data, from the internal network to the outside. So the encrypted for everybody, which means that can be used to pass malicious software or leak sensitive information. So to prevent that from happening, we need to implement some kind of a man in the middle method, or man in the middle attack, but from the good guys, right? So rather than having end-to-end encryption from the client to a server, we use proxy. And we talked about proxies before, where the job of the proxy is actually to be the man in the middle, instead of having an encrypted session from the client to the server directly. We will have a session from the client to the proxy. The session will be encrypted between the two, but once it gets to the proxy will decrypt the traffic, will look at it, implement whatever policies need to be implemented, or it could look at the packet itself, the header and the data, and then allows the traffic to go onward to the server by creating another session from the proxy to the server. So two encrypted sessions while the proxy in the middle. Another point of using the proxy here, or another thing that we can add, in generally speaking, when we use TLS, the clients connect to a server and the server sends its certificate to authenticate itself. But the client, generally speaking, they don't authenticate themselves. We can use in the zero trust scenarios, we need to authenticate both sides because we don't trust anybody. So we may actually implement TLS using certificates from both sides. So the user authenticates itself to the server and the server authenticates itself to the user. We'll call that mutual TLS, and both sides authenticates themselves. We can even go further and make the certificates short-lived, so the certificates can be they expire, but they expire in a month, in a year, and even a decade. But we can make them short-lived, so to increase security. So the short-lived certificate would be good for users who maybe access them for one day and then they need another certificate. So that tightens the security even further. There is another a challenge of the encryption is that any encrypted traffic cannot be seen by anybody unless it's a proxy. So if you have an IDS system or IPS system which looks at the packets and look at any signatures in the packet, normally that requires that the packet is not encrypted. If the packet is encrypted, then we cannot do anything about it. It just, the IDS would be just able to look at the header and that's it. So when you use this concept of zero trust and the proxies, you have to be aware of this challenge with the IDS IPS systems. So speaking of IDS IPS, this is another way to implement zero trust concepts. In previous lectures, we talked about mostly the network-based IDS IPS. We mentioned briefly that IDS IPS can be host-based, right? So a host-based IDS IPS can play a role also in deployment of zero trust. So let's go back and look at these briefly. So a user here can have host-based IDS, IPS systems. This will monitor the traffic, detect any anomalies, allow the traffic to go to a network-based IDS, IPS. And from that, we can go to the resource, and the resource it has the policy enforcement point, and also there is a host-based IDS IPS system, and the dark lines in between describe encrypted tunnels. So the traffic would be all the way encrypted. Now, as I mentioned before, the encrypted traffic cannot be seen by the IDS. It would be able to see only the volume of the traffic and the header. So the IDS may recognize the volume, the patterns of the traffic, but not the inside. It's not the payload. So we call that resource-based model. This requires that we have the HIDS in every resource. This is an expensive model, of course. We can go a little bit more coarse, or rather than more granular. We can have the the policy enforcement point covering an enclave or a subnet, and there is the encryption will terminate at the PEP, and then from that we'll go to the NIDS, and then goes to the resources which have the host-based IDS IPS. So the benefit of that is now the IDS system will be able to see the traffic, will be able to see the unencrypted traffic, and will be able to make decisions based on the content of the packets. Another model useful for cloud, or this can be implemented using the cloud. So the user, before accessing the network side, will pass the traffic to a zero trust aware network IDS. All the traffic from the cloud, or all the traffic from the user to the cloud, is encrypted, and then from the cloud to the network is also encrypted. As before, the PEP will decrypt the traffic and pass it through the network as before here. So the difference between scenario B and scenario C is just where the implementation of the IDS. Finally, we have the scenario D, which is the micro-segmentation. The micro-segmentation has the PEP and HIDPS in both sides, not just the network side, but the client as well. And we will see, this implementation in the next few slides. It's one of the implementation of the Zero Trust, where this is a good example of one server is talking to another server, right? So everything has to go through the PEP and the host-based IDS. Okay, so you will see here that there are certain advantages to each one. Host-based IDS operate on host, accessing network traffic behind PEPs, allowing examination and alerting based on zero trust risk scores. The zero trust integration benefits, it allows the ID or IPS systems to respond to intrusions by requesting setup authentication or quarantining user devices. So I think I mentioned all of these can be enforced by the IDS IPS systems. This slide is almost identical to the previous one. VPNs. VPNs, in the context of zero trust, we can think about them as security tools, or remote access tools, I should say, not security mechanisms, because of the reasons I mentioned before. Any encrypted traffic does not guarantee that the traffic is legitimate, right? It could be a malicious traffic going encrypted. So from the zero trust point of view, it's not enough to have encryption, but also we need to look at other factors as well. VPNs has the benefit of allowing remote users to access multiple resources from different locations. In this picture here, you see that a user can create a VPN tunnel to cloud resources, to resources in different buildings or different sites, all using the same mechanism, right? Here you see in the There is identity management systems connecting to policy decision, and this will authenticate the user and grant them access or deny them access. The user, if they are allowed access, they can use the VPN tunnel to connect to a remote resource using the PEP here, which is the policy enforcement point. Remember that what actually enforces the decision made by the PDP. So if the user is allowed, then they can go and access the resources inside. So this is another way to implement zero trust with VPNs. Yet another way to implement zero trust architecture is by using what is known as next generation firewalls. When we talked about firewalls, I mentioned that the term next generation firewalls means a device or a logical virtual machine, for example, that includes multiple services, not just a simple packet filter, which is the original firewall, but multiple services as well. So you can have a network next generation firewall that implements IDS, implements URL filtering, implements encryption, implements multiple things. So you could use network generation firewall as one of these components, like the PEP, for example. So let's take a look at what we can do here. So the next generation firewall can be what implements the policy enforcement point. So the PEP is practically a next generation firewall. And you can see here there are different implementation of this concept. So in this implementation scenario A, we have only a firewall, a core firewall. The user can will have a user agent PEP, which is software implemented on their side that enforces the policy. The traffic will go encrypted through the core firewall. The core firewall will not be able to decrypt the traffic, so it will just make decisions whether to pass the traffic along or not based on just header information. The PEP at the end here on the other side, the infrastructure side will decrypt the traffic, and then it will pass through IDS or any kind of other filtering, etc., in order to get to the resource. Now, scenario B will have next generation firewall. It works as the logical PEP. Traffic will go encrypted. It will be decrypted by the firewall, and it implements the IDS filtering, anything else. So in this case, the firewall would be practically a proxy, right? Server proxy. So because it needs to decrypt the traffic, so it will it it's here in the scenario A, the traffic is transparent to the user, right? So it will go as far as as the user knows, it goes directly to the trust zone here. As we know from proxies, they are not transparent. So the user has to be configured to talk to the next generation firewall instead of the directly to the resource. So the traffic will be decrypted, checked by different control mechanisms. Then the firewall will re-encrypt it again and pass it to the other PEP, which will decrypt it, and inside this will be the implicit trust zone where the traffic will be secured here. In the final scenario C, we have the implicit trust zone is extended So the next generation firewall won't be external to the zone, but it will be at the gate. And the traffic will be encrypted up to the next generation firewall, and then beyond that, it will be decrypted and passed to the other mechanisms there. So each one of these scenarios has a certain implementation details here. Zero trust is implemented in almost all cloud services. I think it's a necessity of cloud services, but the methods are different. It depends on what kind of a service is offered. So we know there is an infrastructure as a service or platform as a service environment. So in infrastructure as a service, we may need to have an enclave-based implementation where multiple services will be put in a virtual segment or a VLAN, and then we'll have that VLAN, or before we get into that VLAN, we have to pass it through our PEP. Here, because there are many cloud service providers or CSPs, each one of them has already some form of zero trust model implemented. So if you have the option of using one of those cloud service provider options, then you should, rather than implementing your own solution, because their solutions will be integrated with their infrastructure, and it will be ideal to use and optimized for that. Generally speaking, access controls, or that you'll see here in the picture, that the traffic will go encrypted up to a certain level using public IP addresses. And then the traffic will be decrypted and goes inside the private network that's created to hold the resources, right? So it says here that the best or the most effective way to implement the zero trust architecture is when the PEP policy performance point is external to the resource rather than like at the gate, right? So you see here, this is what it means. What else we can say? Another mechanism to implement zero trust architecture is to filter traffic based on IP addresses, and more specifically public IP addresses. So we can, for example, at the edge here, we can say, well, traffic only is allowed to come from this particular network, which is in this case the organization network that has this cloud services implemented. So we can implement this based on the public IP address of that network of that organization. So this is the idea behind zero trust in cloud services. Now there are a couple of more implementations that I find interesting, and we mentioned them before in certain cases. So some vendors have this concept of internal segmentation firewalls, and the idea behind them is to implement the zero trust architecture. So if you noticed, older firewalls come with maybe two or four ports, internal connection, external connection, and then maybe two for demilitarized zone and other networks. So they have a limited number of ports. Modern firewalls come with a lot of ports, 24, 48 ports with different type of interfaces. The reason behind that is the expectation that these services, these firewalls, will be used to connect multiple segments, not just internal versus outside, and that's it. You need to organizations nowadays, they divide the network into multiple segments, which is in compliance or aligned with the concept of zero trust architecture. So we need multiple interfaces, not just very few, four. So that's one aspect of it. But you can also, some vendors will term some of these firewalls as internal segmentation firewalls. And from the name, they mean that we're not going to use these firewalls just to separate the outside network from the inside network, but we also want to use them in the inside network. So they are for internal segmentation. So some of them you can use them as or to replace a switch. So instead of using a switch, you can use a firewall or one of these internal segmentation firewalls. So what there are common characteristics. So they are usually located at the access tier. Access tier is where all is the tier that or the network tier that's responsible for connecting to endpoints. Endpoints here could be servers, desktops, cameras, phones, whatever. It operates at layer two. Normally, firewalls they operate at layer three and above. But these firewalls look at the data link traffic, the Ethernet traffic, right? And they work also transparently, which means that you don't need to configure them in any special way to route or anything. They work as they will look at traffic coming in and out of the ports and apply security policies without having to segment your network into multiple segments. If you have a firewall, a regular firewall with six different ports, then each port will have a different network, different segment with different IP address and all of that. But these the internal segmentation firewalls are supposed to work as a layer two switch, and all the traffic can be in one subnet, right? And it will still monitor traffic and apply certain packet filtering rules at layer two, or layer two and above, I should say. So you can see them being implemented in the inside network. Another concept which came described in previous slides is the micro-segmentation. So the micro-segmentation, rather than having an enclave using the same terminology before, so rather than having servers put in one segment here, and then we have a firewall that controls the traffic in and out of the segment. This one, okay, so it implements zero trust architecture, but at a higher level a little bit, or a coarse level. So the traffic, once it gets to the database VLAN, the traffic will go anywhere in the VLAN. Same thing with the application VLAN or the services management VLAN. So the traffic, once in, it's in to all of them, right? While in the micro segmentation concept, each one of these servers will have its own firewall, or as we have seen before, its own firewall and also IDS, IPS system. So this is another view of the same concept. Because we have multiple firewalls now, management becomes a little bit difficult. So you have to orchestrate or manage all of these individual firewalls. So usually the solution will include some centralized control where from one point in the network you can configure all of these firewalls. With individual policies if needed, but each one of these firewalls I call them firewalls, but they could be also other devices, right? So the concept is the same for micro-segmentation, but these are all, let's call them PEPs, so to make it general. So these are policy enforcement points, and there is one PDB somewhere that sent them the instructions. Right. Okay, so the previous or this slide concludes all the topics about zero trust architecture from the references that I mentioned at the top of the slides. But we also have some older concept which I find relevant in this context, so that I want to cover a little bit. So in a slightly older reference, there is a mention of IT security domains. The IT security domains is another form of zoning that we talked about in previous lecture. But in this case, with zoning, we talked about separating the network into segments. Each zone or segment will have devices that share the same security characteristics, same security requirements, same risks, etc., etc. So I may say, okay, all the application servers will be in one zone because they all share the same risk. They all have the same, they all represent a critical infrastructure for the organization. This is a similar concept, but it divides the security into domains, and each domain will have a specific characteristic. Now, you may go and subdivide each domain into multiple domains as well. So, but this is just general ideas. So, we have seven domains: user, workstations, LAN, LAN to man, LAN to WAN, and WAN, remote access, and applications. So each one of them has different characteristic and will be useful to recognize what are the specific characteristics of each before we conclude this lecture. So the user domain contains all the users, the actual people who access the network resources, such as the network resources in this case, the computers, laptops, mobile devices, etc. From the security point of view, this could be the highest risk to any organization, right? Because users make mistakes. They may actually circumvent some of the security mechanisms because of various reasons, maybe negligence, maybe lack of knowledge, and of course, because of or for malicious reasons. So, you cannot secure a network without also educating the users. So to secure this domain, to secure the users, you need to have training about security best practices. You need to have acceptable use policy. These are sometimes contracts that employees sign, says we are aware of these limitations. We are allowed to do this, but we're not allowed to do that. So these are the rules of using the infrastructure. And then some organizations, well, first of all, you don't want to hire somebody you don't trust. So some organizations will go and do some criminal background check to ensure that their users are trusted, especially for some sensitive positions. So that's the first domain. It's not technical, but related to users. The other domain is the workstation domain, and this includes all the devices that the endpoints that connect to the network itself, with the exception of the servers and databases. So these are the devices that the users access, right? So the users need to access the resources using devices. So this includes desktops, laptops, VoIP phones, etc., and These need to be secured, need to secured by hardening them if they are under our control. So we need to have, we need to make sure that they are patched properly, operating systems upgraded, any vulnerabilities being discovered and avoided or covered. So we need to do all of this. And in the context of bring your own device, this we need to implement some of the mechanism we talked about earlier. So either allow them only to a specific network for guests, or implement certain software, have a limitation in the use of the device itself, right? If we move along, so this is the LAN domain. This is where all of our LAN infrastructure resides. That includes routers, switches, access points, anything that has anything that is part of the network infrastructure. Securing this part includes a lot of things, but includes also restricting management access, making sure that only authorized people can access these resources. And we need to also implement authorization, authentication, and accounting practices here. The domain that received in the past a lot of attention is the LAN to WAN domain. This is where the edge or the gateway between the internal network and the outside, right? And traditionally, before the Zero Trust architecture, this is where all the effort of securing the network goes. So we put a firewall, proxies, terminate VPNs, etc., etc. In traditional networks, we trust the inside, we don't trust the outside. So we put all of the fortifications in the LAN to WAN domain. It's still important because we still need to access the untrusted outside network. So we need to put the, we spent a lot of time talking about this part, this domain in previous topics. Then we talk about the WAN domain. The WAN domain includes everything outside. So the WAN, we call it here the WAN, but it includes the internet as well. So it includes all the connections to the outside, because these connections, they either go through ISP or go to the internet or go to a service provider. They go to somebody else's network or through somebody else's network. So inherently, they're not trusted, right? And we need to secure this domain either by encryption or by using or by SLAs or by having leased lines and certain contracts with service providers to ensure that these connections are secure and trusted. Remote access is another domain. With remote access, we are referring to devices that are being used, but they're not within the perimeter. They're being used from the outside. Remote users allow use these devices to log in. The inherent risk of these devices is that because they are not under our control, they're not even connected to our network, with the exception of the VPN. So if they are vulnerable, then they can be used to launch an attack against us. If there is a virus in that laptop, it will find its way through the encrypted tunnel to the inside network. A remote user can also maliciously attack our network through these. So we need to ensure strong authentication. We need to make sure that we have authorized access. And we need to make sure that there is no data leakage or the other way, or having a malicious software coming in. So we need to monitor both ends, the user end and the end in our side here, whether it's terminate at the firewall or a DMZ or a special VPN appliance, as we said before. And the seventh and the last domain is the applications. Typically and traditionally, this is where most of the mission critical applications are. This is where the business is done for a typical organization. We have the applications that are on that the business use. We have the databases. We have the data. So this is very critical, and it requires special restrictions. When we talked about zones, we classify this as the restricted zone. So this needs to the utmost restrictions. And also, from the trust point of view, this is the most trusted. One thing I want to mention about this domain is that traditionally this domain was inside the network. If you look at this parameter here, this is the boundary, and everything here under our control. But now with the cloud services, this part can be somewhere else outside, right? And we can go to it using a VPN or using some other form of a direct connection to the service. So this can move also to the cloud. That doesn't make it any less important or relieve the security people from securing it. You still need to secure this. And when we talk about cloud security, we will talk about the shared security model, where some of the security functions are shared between the user of the cloud and the cloud service provider as well, right? So with that being said, that concludes the lecture. And thank you for listening, and we'll see you and talk to you in a different lecture.